All right, well, I'm excited to be here and be a part of this conference. I've thought a lot about what I would like to say and share with you today. I am not super interesting, and that maybe a lot of you don't necessarily remember me, nor should you, really. But so I have a video to kind of give us some context to what I'll speak about today, and then we'll move from there. Bear in mind, it's woefully out of date. A lot has happened since a lot of these things on the video, but I think it's helpful to provide some context. So share that to begin with.
Have come close before, but this year they have more firepower on the court. A redhead who overcame a life of addiction to climb his way to the top. Kate Lynch with the dramatic story of Gary Wilkinson.
It's game night. The Breakers are sitting pretty atop the ANBL ladder. Their first championship title within reach. But there's something different about the team this year, and his name is Gary Wilkinson, the flame-haired American who's a joker off the court.
A great locker room presence, and he's goofy too.
But when it comes to winning, he couldn't be more serious.
My uncle said if you don't bow, shine like you sell bricks.
It's that same positive attitude Wilkinson used to overcome adversity as a teenager. He dropped out of school and lived a life of addiction.
Pretty much everything that you can think of, drugs and alcohol and smoking and all of those type of things were really a huge part of my life from the morning I woke up to when I went to bed at 5 in the morning, you know. That's what my life consisted of. I started getting with kids that really were in the same boat. They didn't have any direction, any structure, and they kind of liked to go out and party and have a good time, and I took that to an extreme.
The then 18-year-old's world suddenly came crashing down.
For me, when Tyler, or my friend, committed suicide, when that happened, it really started to make me think, okay, where's my life now headed, and where am I going to end up? Am I going to end up feeling the same way?
Wilkinson got clean, and the guy who hadn't touched a basketball in years got a scholarship, got picked for his college basketball team, became their MVP, and led them to back-to-back titles.
I saw more to myself than what I was doing. There was more to me, and there was more for me to accomplish in life.
He played in Korea and Greece before joining the Breakers last year. Wilkinson and wife Jessica are expecting their own baby boy in a few weeks.
He likes basketball. He goes crazy at the games. He gets kicking and moving and shaking. So I guess it's in the blood. I don't know. But he loves the Breakers games.
So does his dad.
He's very passionate. He gets excited on the court, and it's contagious. And the fans feel it. I think his teammates feel it. And that's one thing I love about him, and I love when I can go watch him at games.
Wilkinson truly believes that this year the Breakers have the talent to take the title.
I don't think I would be a competitor if I didn't believe I was going to win every game, you know, and that's if you don't have that attitude when I step on the floor. If you don't believe that you're going to win this next game, if you don't believe you're going to win a championship, what are you working for? You know, why do it? And that's, I think that goes into everything in life. If you don't believe that you're capable, or if you're going to do it, you're not.
All right, so thank you. Like I said, a lot has happened, so we have way more kids than that now, and law school's over with, thankfully, and we've moved on from there. But as I've thought about resilience through caring. And I think this conference is maybe, in general, a more outward-focused conference, how we can connect with one another through caring to help and benefit the lives of each other. And I want to focus on, with my presentation, on caring in respect to yourself and how that is a catalyst for connecting with others in a meaningful way, because I'd fly on planes all the time overseas, and in Estonia it was really scary, but and Russia. But you'd always hear, and I'm sure most of you have heard this before, but you know, it dawned on me when they tell you to put your mask on yourself first. I'm like, yeah, that's true, because if you're not taken care of, you're not going to do anything to help anybody else, because you're incapacitated. And I think that's true in life. If you don't take time to take care of yourself and do some self-work, some self-actualization, some introspective effort, take some introspective effort, you're not going to be able to really reach out in meaningful ways and help others to achieve what it is they want to achieve and be in a meaningful, have a meaningful impact in their life. So that's kind of going to be the context of what I'm going to talk to you about today. And fill in a lot of the gaps that video left. That was a real general overlay of what kind of I went through. So I wanted, in this context, I want to define resilience as not resting on past tragedy or triumph when facing the future, okay? And triumph is kind of an interesting one, but tragedy is kind of a bit melodramatic, but I think in these terms, but I thought it sounded good with triumph, so that's why I said that. So in tragedy or the adversity or the challenging circumstances that we face in life, there I kind of categorize them in two categories. And the first is tragedy or adversity that we bring on ourselves through our own choices. Okay, for me, that was drug abuse or other self-destructive behavior that we engage in that brings challenges in our lives. And so that's one type of tragedy. The other type of tragedy is one that we have no choice in, that we did nothing to to take part in, but it had an effect on us. Sexual abuse, mental abuse, physical abuse, all of those other things. For me, the suicide of my friend, I had no choice in that, but it had a dramatic impact on me, and it's something that I had to grapple with. And I think those are really difficult circumstances, right? When you have no culpability in the tragic circumstance, but you're left with the fallout, and you have to deal with that. And that is extremely challenging. I'm not going to speak on the broader context, only on what I experienced, because I think that's all I can really speak to with respect to that. And the final thing is triumph. And we don't often think of resilience in terms of our successes, but I've come to understand that really when you've reached your goals in life, or you've reached some of your goals, it takes a lot of resilience to then set different and higher goals, and not to rest on the things that you've accomplished, because that results in entitlement and complacency in your life. You become complacent, and then you become unhappy, and then all those other things that result from that. And so I'll speak a little bit on that and the experiences that I've had with respect to that. So there's choice and tragedy. When I was at Utah State, we were really good. And like last year, we were really good. We were 17th in the country, longest winning streak, and we're just dominating. And we had a lot of people coming in, New York Times, Washington Post, ESPN, Sports Illustrated, all of these different outlets wanted to come in. And Greg Bishop, one of the New York Times authors, I thought it was actually quite funny, because he said no others took the route of Gary Wilkinson, the Aggies, 26-year-old, which is really old for college basketball, leading scorer and rebounder during his senior season at Bingham High School in South Jordan, Utah. He decided that nothing he learned in school prepared him for life after. Faced with the choice of partying or studying, he dropped out. And that was true, for sure it was true. A lot of people that I've talked with about these circumstances, you know, think, well, what are you going to tell your kids? You've dropped out of high school, but then you did all of this. And my simple response is, look at your mom. She's a way better example than I am. Don't worry about me. So, when I was in high school, I had no drive. And I think a lot of it resulted from I didn't structure my life. My parents were really successful. My dad was really successful. I had everything handed to me. I had no excuses whatsoever. Great family home, da 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 da. But I lacked any ambition, and really anything that was challenging to me, I just steered away from. So path of least resistance was my goal. And so and growing up, I was really good at basketball. So I didn't even try out my freshman year at Bingham High School in South Jordan. And then my sophomore year, my dad is really like, you need to do something. So I went to tryouts, and I was making my way through, and then the coach is like, Gary, you need to go down on the block, go down to the, you know, you're going to post up. And I told him, I'm like, hey, I don't play on the block. And that was the end of my high school basketball career before it even started. And so I was cut in 1998. I didn't try out as a junior or senior. But during my junior year, I really started into heavy drug use. And eventually that led to me dropping out of high school. I remember the day specifically. I walked into school really late. And it was my senior year, so I was on track to still graduate. But I just told myself, like, I don't feel like, you know, I'm learning anything here, I'm getting anything of value, and which maybe a lot of high school students feel. The difference between them and me is they have some smarts, and they stick it out. But I walked into class and realized that it wasn't for me, so I left. If I had to do it all over again, you know, I look back, I don't really regret a lot of things in life, because I look at your past as opportunity, right? I don't, you know, there are obviously things that I regret. The thing that I do regret is that there's a lot to be learned from sticking with situations that you don't necessarily see any value in, because commitment and stick-to-itiveness are characteristics that will eventually lead to some tremendous results. And so high school, I guess, if I look back on it, would have been one of those opportunities to demonstrate those characteristics. Other than that, I didn't find too much value. Okay, so my wife told me, she's like, you always talk about that you did drugs. But then you're like, well, what drugs? And I was just like, well, if I took time to list them all, we'd run out of time. But here's a few. So I started with, I didn't start with cocaine, but cocaine was my drug of choice. And then ecstasy, opium, mescaline, crack, LSD, alcohol, pot. And this particular type of pot has dual functions. You can put plants in it and smoke the plants that grow in it. So I just got tired of looking up the other drugs that I did. So that's just to name a few. And so I took that to an excess. It was a nightly thing that I engaged in. And so I got involved with a group of friends who, like I said in the video, that were kind of in my same boat, right? We didn't really have any use for school, and they didn't really have any direction, any purpose, any focus. And so we got heavy into this stuff. And night in and night out, that's what our life would be. And we were spending, and my dad was well off, and so I had endless funds at my disposal so I could spend. And looking back, you know, it's hard to say whether that was an enabling factor in terms of my own abuse or not. And I think to a certain extent it is. And one of the challenging things is, with respect to my situation, is I'm an outlier, right? Like I'm not the norm. When you're that full in to those heavy drugs, your life doesn't generally turn out like my life is now turning out. And I think that's the real issue when my kids are too young to really understand at this point. But as they grow older, my I guess soapbox speech to them will be, look, it's a matter of statistics. It's not a matter of whether you can or can't. You don't want to find out whether you can or can't. Right? You don't want to find out because the can't is a far more likely scenario than the can. And so the best course of action is to stay away from the things that are going to prevent you from accomplishing what it is you want to accomplish in life. And so set goals that kind of steer you away from heading down that path. You know, although if they do, we can have that talk as it comes. And so through the course of the drug use, I got involved with this young man, Tyler. Tyler was a good kid. He had a lot. He had a lot going for him. His dad is a judge in Salt Lake. He just had like a patch of just terrible things happen to him. And so he started hanging out with us. And we were just, and his, like my drug use was on this level, and his was like here. And I was like, I don't know how he's gonna, because this is the thing, I'm a big guy. So I can do a lot of drugs, and they don't have an effect on me like a guy like this tall or a person. It's true. Like even when I go to the hospital, if they wanna put me out, it's like you need what you'd give a horse or something, you know? But his drug use was on a different level. And so, you know, I remember we were out partying and I went home and went to bed, and the next morning, we got in super, I guess it'd be next morning afternoon, I got a call that Tyler that night went home and took his own life. And anyone who's experienced suicide, and hopefully not many of you have, it's something that just kind of just disorients you in so many ways. And to a certain extent, it really leads you to start questioning a lot about your life and about who you are and where you're headed. Hopefully, it leads to a level of introspection. And that is something that I don't understand, and I think anyone who's experienced it, really, it's hard to grapple with and really understand why a person would make that choice. For me, it got me thinking about my own circumstances and what Tyler was thinking about when he decided to take his life. What did he feel, and what did he think, and why did he think that there was nothing that he was gonna do in the future that would alleviate him from the pain that he was feeling at that time? And those were really hard questions to start to ask yourself at 18, at 50, at 75, at whatever age you are. But they resulted from Tyler's death. And to a certain extent, I mean, if this is even a true statement, but his death really wasn't in vain, because it became a foundation piece. A foundation piece for me to begin to build on. And so as I talked about earlier, I've categorized these two kind of tragedies that I focused on today. My drug abuse, the one that I had a choice in, and my friend's suicide, the one that I didn't have a choice in. And so these are kind of the principles that I've derived from these experiences. So where there's choice in the tragedy, resilience begins with taking responsibility. And for me, it was, you know, to a certain extent, Tyler's death, that and those questions that I began to ask myself: how did I get here? And where am I going? And what do I need to do to change? And it was extremely difficult, like unbelievably difficult. I think when you're talking about change, and it's a little bit easier when you're the one who made the choice to bring the adversity upon yourself to start making these changes. But you need to start with the bottom line is confidence. And I've had the opportunity to speak all over the world, and share with youth groups in Australia, Estonia, all over. And one of the things I tell, and a lot of them are youth, but I think it's extremely applicable to adults, because so many things start with people questioning whether they can or can't. That question should go out the door. It's not even something that you should even be worrying about at the beginning, at the end, at the middle, because who cares? Who cares whether you can or can't? Life will tell you. It will. Life will dictate to you whether you can do something or you can't. And you'll find out. But don't limit yourself from the beginning by posing the question. Who cares? Because the reality of it is, your strength as an individual is derived from your willingness to put forth effort and do things that challenge you. Because in the end, through all that I've seen and all I've accomplished, my accomplishments in terms of the worldly recognition or successes are meaningless. Because, I mean, for whatever, like, player of the year at Utah State, I don't even know where that trophy is. Honestly, I don't. But I don't care. Because it was the effort, the dedication, the sacrifice, the focus, the confidence, everything that took me to that place that actually means something to me. It doesn't... What I put on a shelf or whatever is meaningless, because those attributes and those characteristics that are derived from the effort that I put forth are what allow me to continually strive to become better than I was yesterday. And so confidence is like the key component in terms of being resilient. You have to have an outlook, a positive perspective on your own capacity to accomplish something. That's the key component. And then once you have that outlook, and then the steps and the hard work becomes. That's where people really get scared. There's a quote, Nelson Mandela quoted it during his inaugural speech, and it's a quote by a woman named Marianne Williamson. It's, I'm sure all of you have heard it before, but it says something to the extent that it's not the darkness that's within us that most frightens us, it's the light. And I think people are more scared of being great than they are of failure because of the responsibility and what it takes to be great. And greatness is a subjective term, right? What's great to me isn't what's great to you. But what's great to you is probably what scares you the most. And being what it takes to be that type of individual, that's scary. It really is. Failure is, it's scary, and we don't want to fail, but failure is an opportunity, but that's a whole other talk. And so the next thing I learned about is sacrifice. And that, so I am like, okay, I'm stopping drugs. So I remember on January 1st, 2001, I told all my friends, I'm like, look, this is it for me. I'm out. So we're going to party like it's 1999, but it's 2001. And we got a ton of drugs, and I went for it. And the next day, I'm like, that's it. I'm done. And they're like, we've heard that before. And I was like, no, I'm dead. I'm done. I know I'm done. And so I cut ties with all of them. Said, I can't. Like this notion, and I watch my friends, and I still watch my friends who battle with addiction. They say, I'm done, and then I'm going to go back. I'm going to turn back to the same people. And it's not those people's fault, but you create these circumstances, this self-destructive cycle that you can't escape from. And I think that's true, whether it's drug abuse or whatever it is that you and I struggle with, which we all have our struggles. We got to turn ourselves away from those things that are enabling to the behavior which we're trying to change, right? And so I cut ties with my friends, and it was really hard because we had been through a lot. Went through Tyler's death. We were really connected. They were my world. Like, I love my family, and now I'm extremely close with my family, but I wasn't really connected with them. And that's the one hard thing about drugs, is because, especially like ecstasy and cocaine, you become really open and really vulnerable to people. And it feels good to be vulnerable. It feels good to be open and connected. And those help you to be vulnerable, open, connected. The problem is it doesn't last. And you can't obtain that type of vulnerability without it. And so you want to turn to it, and you want to be connected, and you want to feel close, and then you leave it, and you're like, well, how am I supposed to do that? I had to learn to go bowling sober. I really did. I mean, not to bowl. I still can't bowl, but I had to learn how to have fun as a sober individual, like how to connect with people as a sober individual, how to find meaning and purpose in the mundane, monotonous thing that is life. It's really hard. It's really hard. And for drug users who just love this exhilarating, fast-paced, like hard-hitting life, it's just like, yeah. And then you're like, I'm going to go to work 9 to 5, work at a call center, maybe at Best Buy, but I'm sober. Yay. You know? It's like, that's really what's challenging about it, right? Like, you don't have any like bright prospects. You can't see what's ahead of you. You really can't. And so you just got to be like, which leads me to my next point, is you got to take it day by day. Because the great things that are going to result from your effort of changing and being resilient are pretty much unforeseeable. But it's only when we look back in retrospect that we see the small day-to-day efforts have yielded some unbelievable results. We've seen the change, a gradual change over the course of our life that has come from making a choice to challenge ourselves and to face adversity with a sense of confidence, with a willingness to sacrifice those things that hold us back, and a willingness to take it day by day. And so that's the approach that that I've taken, and I've tried to take that in every aspect of my life when I'm facing new challenges or adversity or what have you. And so where there's no choice in tragedy, resilience begins with not allowing the tragedy to become the justification for future tragic choices, right? So what I mean by that is this. When Tyler died, I used his death in part as a justification for more self-destructive behavior. When he died, I went and got high and said, man, I need to self-medicate. I need to do these things because I don't know how to deal with this. And I turned back to the things that were limiting. I turned back to the things that were not going to help me. And I think that's the only choice that we really can make when the things that happen to us were not of our making. When we suffer through abuse, we can't change that. And we had no choice in that. And so you have to find a place where your choice begins, right? You have to find a place where your choice begins, where you can begin to take responsibility. Because if you take responsibility for the things that you can change, and you make the choices based on what you can control, you're going to find a sense of peace and understanding about the things that you couldn't control. And it's really hard. It's really hard. And the thing is no one can blame the individuals who don't do it, right? You can't. Because it's that hard. It's really difficult to relate. But I've learned if you can do that, you're gonna find yourself being able to understand and to overcome and to become at peace with the things that you can't control. And you can look back and say, yep, I had nothing to do with that, but I can move forward and I can be resilient and I can overcome and I can face that challenge with a sense of confidence. And so that's how I faced those kind of variables. And they've taken many forms in my life, right? And I'm sure there's more to come. But I'm sure you can fill in this story with your own experiences. That's kind of what's helped me with the tragedy aspect. And so what's kind of come of my resilience? Oh, I want to go back. I didn't know how many slides were there. Let's see. There we are. All right. So I dropped out of high school. I started like, okay, I gotta make these changes. I got my GED. And then some years down the line, after I got my GED, I was like, okay, I don't want to pay for college. So I decided, well, I was pretty good at basketball. And I called up the coach at Salt Lake Community College, Norm Parrish, and I said, hey, I want to come try out for your basketball team, which is, this is like, looking back on it, how silly I sounded, but I didn't know, you know? So he's like, well, where did you play high school basketball? I was like, well, I didn't. I dropped out. Great start. Great start. And then, you know, we... through the conversation, it's just going downhill. Luckily, serendipitously, he asked, well, how tall are you? I said, well, I'm 6'9". He said, come down. It's like, yes. So I went down. I went down to Salt Lake Community College on a Wednesday in June, 3 months before the season even started, and played with them on a Wednesday and played really well. Coach Parrish didn't even show up. So the 6'9 may have got me there, but it didn't get him there. So, but the assistant was there, luckily, and he said, you need to come back on Friday. So I came back 2 days later, played with the team again. Coach Parrish was there, took me up, signed me to a full ride scholarship on the spot. And it was amazing. And I owe so much to Coach Parrish. That was a huge risk. Luckily at Slick, I played really well. Lucky for me and to his credit, I played really well. He gave me a lot of opportunity, and from there I had scholarship offers from, met my wife first and foremost, which was the best thing, and then she played volleyball there. And then scholarship offers from Miami, Texas Tech, Nebraska, Boise State, Fresno State, Utah State, Wyoming, all over the country. And of course, Utah State. Go Aggies. So my wife got a scholarship up here. She played volleyball. I played basketball. We had two tremendous years, played with some of my best friends, JC, Carroll, Ty Wesley, Brady Jardine, all those guys, great guys. And after Utah State, got invited to Jazz Summer League, played Summer League with the Jazz or the Kings. I decided to go with the Jazz. From there, got invited to vet camp, but I had a great offer to go play in South Korea. So I'm like, I'm not going to make the NBA, but I'll go to South Korea. And so had some tremendous experiences. So we played in South Korea, in Greece, 3 years in New Zealand, but we played in Australia, Estonia, and then off seasons in Puerto Rico. And then had my final after Estonia, had an offer to go play in Japan. But ultimately, and then while we were playing, we won three championships, two in New Zealand and one in Estonia. And it was funny, I'm taking a lot of time, but in Estonia, our first championship run, no New Zealand team has ever won an Australian League championship. Like, in the sports over there, it'd be like rugby and cricket, which I'd always say, like, you guys like just basically stole baseball and football and turned them into these weird sports. And they're like, no, that's not true. But during the playoffs, I got into a little scuffle and was on the verge of not being able to play. And luckily the league allowed me to play, but the royal wedding was the same week, and so my pitcher's like right next to the royal couple on the front page, like, Wilkinson can play, the royal wedding happened, you know. It was pretty funny. And so we won championship in New Zealand. It was huge for them because that's their first professional sport that they won. It was a great experience. And then I just wanted to make my life really hard, and so I decided to go to law school. And so I studied, and I took the LSAT while I was at Utah State, but I played basketball for so long that I had to retake it, and what a nightmare. I thought it was a nightmare, then I started taking law school exams, so it wasn't as bad as I initially thought, but got a scholarship to go to law school at the University of Utah, and I loved my time in law school. It was challenging and exhilarating and thought-provoking and amazing. It was hard. And then after that, I got a job at a law firm, but as of now, I'm clerking for Judge Robert Shelby on the United States Federal District Court for the District of Utah. Judge Shelby is also an Aggie alum, so great guy. So I'm going to quickly wrap up because I think I'm about out of time, but this is what I wanted to talk about with resting on triumph. So when I got done with Utah State, I had a lot of personal success. And so when I went to Korea, I was kind of resting on that. I'm like, I've done all these great things. I'm just going to go over here and I'm going to do great and da, 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 da. And I got lit up and I got cut from my South Korean team. And I went to Greece and I still had this waning perspective of my own comp ability and I got lit up again. And it was really hard. And I look back and I'm like, why? What happened? And I was entitled and I was complacent. I'd worked so hard to get where I was. And then I began to rest on my own accomplishments, thinking that was enough. And it isn't. It isn't ever enough. And that's why you have to keep focusing on what it is you can improve on and take. I like this quote. I think it was for some corporate thing, but I stole it. That's trademark infringement, I think. But no, I don't know what it is. But does success breed complacency? To keep your culture winning, go back to the beginning. And that's so true. Never lose sight of what it is that brought you to where you're at. and keep reflecting on those characteristics and those attributes to get you at where it is you want to go. And just in conclusion, when I was at Utah State, we worked really hard in the weight room, and one of the quotes that the weight staff, or one of the quotes on the wall said, "Adversity causes some to break; it causes others to break records." And I've always looked at that like, yep, that's right. It's either you're gonna bounce back and become something better, or you're just gonna allow life's challenges to overwhelm you to the extent that you're not able to be what it is you want to be. And so I unquestionably know and believe that all of us have the capacity to do what it is that we want to do and be who it is we want to be. It's just a matter of whether we're going to make the choice to do it and believe in ourselves enough to give ourselves the opportunity to do it. So my story, although unique, is not something that it should be. It really isn't. I think that we all have that capacity to do those things and to overcome whatever it is we're faced with. So I appreciate your time and thank you very much.